Most of us here who are attending this workshop and have been participating in this workshop for some time are teachers and students at the same time. But then we are predominantly from what is called the heteronormative group of sexuality. And especially when we talk to people from community, we know the kind of language difficulties that we have. Those from the community have difficulties to listen to the language system that comes from a strong heteronormative system. Likewise, when we have to engage with people coming from LGBTIQ or queer communities, we will not be able to understand what they think of our own language. That is because we haven't been able to embody some of the thought processes, emotions, feelings, or narratives of people of queer community. So this workshop is basically to see how far we can go on to embody the ideas of sexuality through our learning and in our teaching, because the idea of sexuality and the debates that emerge out of such engagements are very personal. They're very strongly culturally dependent. They're highly political. And as Duncan was saying, they're highly moralized. We know that queer people do not have a good place in the church. Very rarely a queer person is being welcomed, accommodated into the church and given responsibilities, either to speak or take up administrative responsibilities. And therefore, if we have to listen to the stories from queer communities, they are very personal. Queer members shy away from telling their stories because these stories are very hurtful stories that comes from a very deep-seated hurt that have gone through for many years. And they have come to a conclusion that the dominant heteronormative group is not willing to listen to their stories. And therefore, these groups embody those hurt to such an extent that they isolate themselves from the mainline churches and mainline communities. Because attitudes about sexuality are often bound up in the issues of shame, guilt, power, and freedom. So as we gather here to equip ourselves, both to learn and to teach, we should know that all instructors and learners have certain kind of body. And we should accept that once we are within what is called the heteronormative body, whether we accept it or not, we are already in a privileged society. Although you do not want to feel privileged about it, the people around us look at the so-called perfect man or the so-called perfect woman as a privileged person. And everyone else outside this group is underprivileged. So what have we embodied then? We as instructors, we as learners have embodied these societal biases without our own knowledge. Even if we have claimed, or even if we claim to have been coming out of this learning, coming out or have been unlearning this, still there are people around us who want to privilege us because of our maleness or femaleness. Therefore, we should always know that although you are in solidarity, although we are in solidarity with queer community, on the other hand, there are groups who want to privilege us and look at us as better than others. So in this situation, learning is a process of both increasing knowledge as well as gaining new insights into the meaning and significance of the knowledge. And therefore, a workshop as this should be transformative. And it should add to our thought process. It should reshape our worldview, both of the learners and teachers. And we know that this workshop is being organized for pastors and teachers. As much as we are teachers and pastors, we should with all humility accept that we are learners as well. And we will continue to learn. especially when it comes to teaching and learning sexuality, there is always this question of representation. What type of a resource person am I here or in the classrooms or in the church as a pastor? We should always remember that unless we are from sexual minority communities, all our presentations of images about sexual minorities are only cultural constructs, and such constructs need to be interrogated. In other words, if you are from the dominant sexual community, we should start interrogating our own selves about the images that we have created about the sexual minority communities within our own, within our churches, and within our neighborhood communities. One of the reasons why, I mean, you know that all through the sessions, we have had members from the community come and speak to us. If they hadn't come and spoken to us, we only would have been impoverished resource person. We think that everything that we know is perfect, everything that we know is correct, and that's it. But once we started listening to members of the community from the queer community, we know how impoverished our knowledge system is about sexuality and gender diversity. And therefore, the pedagogic principle of this workshop is not just to bring out academic discussion, but also to listen to the narratives or the stories and lives of members of the community. So there are two principles working here. What is called the agency of the community. So when I use the word agency, agency means the voices of the oppressed or the voices of the minority groups that struggle to break out of such shackles or bondages and try to represent itself. That is agency. This, the word agency is a very philosophical word. And if you have read the philosophy of Michel Foucault, you will come to know very strongly about what representation means. So agency or representation is the voice that struggles to come up, break through the strong bondages and present itself as authentic. Especially when the dominant system has a very strong hold on the minority groups, the voices have to become stronger to come and represent itself. Otherwise, once the dominant starts representing the minority group, they will not represent the minority, rather they represent the majority or the dominant. Or if you had to use the words of Gayatri Spivak, a post-colonial thinker, she says, the subalterns cannot speak. We should not take this idea very literally. It's not that the subalterns cannot speak, not that we were not able to hear their speech, but what they say is not their authentic selves because they are always scared to express their authentic views. Meaning, once they come out, they would be attacked, they would be silenced, their place in the society will be removed, they'll be isolated. So the voices of the subalterns have that fear of being sidelined, so that their voices will not come out anymore. And that's why Gayatri Spivak says, the subalterns cannot speak. Just in case they spoke, you will only hear the voices of the dominant, because the subalterns have to negotiate somewhere through such dominant structure. They have to live their life, because even negotiation is not easy. So unless we understand all these things, we are only impoverished resource persons as teachers, pastors, and also as learners. We all have done our BD and MTH courses and DTH, but one thing we should always stick to is the formative factors. And we should always revisit formative factors. Now that we all have studied liberation theology at some point or the other, liberation theology is a classic example of how formative factors of theology have been revisited. You know, in the traditional formative factors, we have scripture, revelation, tradition, culture, scientific reasoning. So it's always and experience. So scripture comes first, revelation comes next. So we have a very strong orthodoxy way of placing formative factors. But then liberation theology broke into the scene and said, no, we will have to turn the tables around and put experience on the top. That is exactly what I mean when I say revisiting our formative factors with humility. Why I say humility? When experience comes first, especially in the context of sexual diversity and gender diversity, we should be humble enough to stop talking and start listening to the stories and narratives of members of sexually minority communities. Listening only comes with humility. Listening does not come without humility. If you are not humble, we only speak. We try to represent the other in our own style, even without listening to what they have to say. So when we have to teach sexuality, we will have to adopt this method of critiquing the formative factors. Secondly, taking the position of what I call rooted solidarity, meaning moving towards an idea of solidarity where we stop talking and start listening more and slowly start embodying those ideas. And this method and philosophy will help us journey a long way along with sexual minority communities. If we do not revisit our formative factors, if we do not interrogate our formative factors, we only fake the knowledge of having understood the cultural constructs of gender and sexual diversities. We have heard about Edward Said, a very famous post-colonial thinker who revisited the idea of Orientalism and Occidental ideas. I mean, you are wondering what Edward Said is doing there, playing the piano. I mean, if you, just in case you did not know this, Edward Said is basically a musician and he drew all his methods and ideas from music. He used music jargons and developed them into philosophical ideas. And one of the famous philosophical ideas that Edward Said drew out of music was contrapuntality. Reading texts alongside each other, or what is called juxtaposed reading. Why do we have to do juxtaposed readings? Edward Said says, all the images that are constructed in our mind are culturally conditioned. Our discourses of the other, in this case, our discourses of the queer community, are imprisoned in the dominant knowledge system, and therefore the other cannot represent themselves. This raises the important question of representation, as representation cannot be exactly realistic. I'll explain the second part. We listened to Ankit speaking. We listened to Duncan speaking. We won't have spoken like Ankit or Duncan because that is not our experience. Even if we mug up those lines, even if we rehearse those lines, even if we listen to their audios and videos again and again and try to represent, we will not be able to do, because those lines and those rehearsals would be deprived of emotions. Pathos, they are not actual. They cannot be represented because they are not exactly realist. Therefore, all the images that we have about gender and sexual minorities in our minds are basically culturally constructed images. That's what Edward Said has to tell us about how we have to come out of such culturally constructed images. So his method of contrapuntality tells us, on the one hand, we have culturally constructed images. On the other hand, we have a mindset to interrogate ourselves. Otherwise, we continue to colonize ourselves. Colonizers need not come from outside. We always look at the colonizers outside of us, but we do not know that we ourselves are the colonizers. We colonize our minds by talking the language of the dominant communities. We colonize ourselves by privileging ourselves. We colonize ourselves by not wanting to listen to the stories that come from your communities. And therefore, we are stuck within the culturally constructed images. And as long as we are privileged, we do not want to come out of it because we are the beneficiaries. Somehow that will take us a long way. No one will question us. We become very entitled. As long as we're entitled and as long as we are privileged, we do not want to come out of these culturally constructed images. So when we talk about representations, we have to bear a lot of caution. I want all of us to read this article. This article is available online. You can just take down the reference, and this is available online. This is in the context of film and in the context of academics, but very relevant when it comes to idea of whether we represent the sexual minorities properly and exactly when we talk about them. This is about film, but then we can extend this idea to our own mindset. Each filmic and academic utterance must be analyzed not only in terms of who represents, but also in terms of who is being represented for what purpose, which historical moment, for which location, using which strategies, and in what tone of address. I think I'll have to underline these things. Who represents? It's not only about who represents. Who is being represented? For what purpose? Which historical moment? Which location? Which strategy? And which tone? Which tone? Which strategy? Especially when we talk about purpose and historical moment or location sometimes, they are outwardly understandable. Because we can't hide the purpose, we can't hide the location, we can't negate or hide history. But then, those coming from a very dominant sexually privileged group use very subtle strategies, use very subtle tone in our words. And sometimes we are so clever in using our strategies, people will not know that we are trying to suppress someone. That's how good we are in our language and in our language system, because our dominant language system has taught us how to very subtly, how to cleverly, how to shrewdly use certain language system without revealing that we are from the dominant group. And therefore, Ella Shohat says, we should be very cautious about the language system that we inherit through films and through academics. Because heteronormativity has its own baggage. And sometimes, as I said, we will not, really not understand. How many of you know who this person is in this picture? You have to certainly read her works. I already referred to her, Marcel Althaus Reed. I already said how she says heteronormativity is a very closed understanding, orderly, restrictive of the social. And as she said, we are self-colonizing. We get trapped in dualisms without our own knowledge. So having said this, I will go to some of the important theological themes that has been presented in Christian doctrines and Christian theological discourses. So before we go to that, do you have any question to ask or anything to contribute to this discussion before I go to specific themes? Do you have anything to ask that I have talked about so far? If not, then I'll continue with my presentation. I'm talking about the person in the picture is Tertullian of Carthage. Before I come to Tertullian of Carthage, I have to say something. You have gone through the sessions on biblical themes, on the idea of body, idea of soul, idea of mind, dichotomies and trichotomies that scriptures have to offer us, especially Pauline theology. So I'll not be going back to that. But I want us to recall those ideas because the early church very strongly fell back on the teachings of Paul for one reason. The early church fathers followed almost the same philosophical lines that Paul was talking about. And therefore, when they spoke about the doctrine of human body, the doctrine of human person, they broke down the body as body, soul, and spirit, or body, spirit, and mind, trichotomies, or very commonly said, body and soul. And we know that most of the times, the mind and the soul were privileged over body. And that is the line of thought the early church took for quite some time. So we'll start with Tertullian of Carthage, whose time was 155 to 240. He was of the dichotomist view. And the dichotomist view, and Christian theology talks about the nature of the human. I'm talking about the doctrine of human person here. The nature of human consisted of only two elements, that is, body and soul. And this argument is based on the impossibility of separating the activity of the soul and of the spirit. Meaning, when we talk about soul, soul is further inclusive of the idea of spirit. So when dichotomists like Tertullian speak of soul, we should not take soul only at its face value. Deep down within the idea of soul, there is always the working of the spirit. But Tertullian talks about only two things, because Tertullian thinks that God has created us as dichotomous body. There is dichotomous being. There is the body, and then there is the soul. So he doesn't go much about how the spirit works within the soul, and he thinks that once he speak up to the soul, it covers the idea of spirit as well. That's what Tertullian has to say. And before I go further, I will not be touching upon many church fathers or early church teachers here because it takes a lot of time. We do not have so much time. Although I have a lot of material to share, but I'll not be able to do everything. So I've only taken representative church fathers or early church teachers. So Tertullian represents the dichotomist view. I bring in these technical words because we all are theologically trained and we teach at BD and we teach at MTS level, you are doctoral students. So it's easy for me to be a bit more jargonistic because you are able to grasp them. Because you have been students, you have been teachers, and you teach them. So I take advantage of that and try to keep some of my presentation as jargonistic as possible because that's the easiest way to communicate among the peers. Then there is something called the trichotomist view. And this is Irenaeus of Lyons. Irenaeus of Lyons talks about the human nature or the doctrine of the human being distinguished into three elements, body, soul, and spirit. And then he further breaks down the idea of soul and the spirit. Soul is higher than the spirit. The soul is the mediator between anything that is higher than it and the body. What is Irenaeus doing here is he's Christianizing the whole idea of the dichotomy. By Christianizing, I mean he breaks the idea of the soul into soul and spirit. What Irenaeus also goes on to say that when we talk about spirit, or when we talk about soul, that is where the working of Jesus Christ comes in. Whereas in the previous thought, we talk about Tertullian, it does not bring in the idea of Christ so much, but Irenaeus makes it more Christian. Tertullian kept it more philosophical, but Irenaeus makes it more Christian philosophical by breaking the idea of soul down to soul and spirit. And he says, this soul which has received Jesus is more privileged than any other soul that has not received Jesus. Okay, that is the doctrine of human being of Irenaeus. Why I say all these things is, it is this kind of the division of body and soul, it is this kind of division of human being as body, soul, and spirit that we have been handed down from generation to generation. And even now, we rest all our debates on these kind of dichotomies or trichotomies. We haven't come out of it. And it's very difficult for us to come out of it. Before I move further, because we all are theological teachers, I want us to talk about how you have understood dichotomies and trichotomies in your own faith formation, in your own theological teaching. I think I'll give we'll have 2 or 3 minutes before I go forward. And it's good that we discuss than just me talking here all the time. How have you understood binaries? And how have you understood these dichotomies and trichotomies, especially when you teach, when you preach? Have you been able to grasp with such distinctions? Have you been struggling with these questions? So what has been happening in your own faith journey? Come on, teachers talk all the time. And this was the time for you to talk. Looks like Jyoti has very clearly instructed everyone not to talk. Jyoti, have you been controlling their mics?
Everyone can unmute themselves and then they can speak.
Thanks, Vijay. Thank you. I mean, because we all are teachers, we all struggle with these ideas of dichotomy and trichotomies. So I might look like a resource person here, but we all are resource persons. That's what I said earlier on. We all are teachers at some level. We are pastors, we are teachers. We struggle with these ideas. How have you handled these ideas when you have taught or when you have preached? I'm tempted to call out the names of my students, but I will not do that.
Well, before you call out my name, sir.
Thank you, sir.
The dichotomy, of course, it's always, as for me, it's easier to understand. It's just male and female. But when we talk about the trial or the trichotomy, it is very difficult for me to distinguish which one is a soul and which one is a spirit. And even when it comes to the gender, you know, there's always a struggle. There's still a lot of unanswered questions. So I struggle. I honestly struggle with the dichotomy. With the trichotomy. But when it comes to just the two, I have no problem with that, sir.
Why do you not have a problem with the two? Why do you feel so comfortable?
I think it's because the two is so much known, you know. Like even we look, for example, we look at our parents, you know, it's male and female, and even when they talk to us about gender or sexuality. It's just male or female. So we have the understanding right from the beginning. And even it's like the body and soul. We know this body will perish, but the soul will be eternal, and it will, you know, the soul will go to God. That's how we I understand, and that's how my parents have also, you know, talked about it. So for that, I don't have a problem. But when we talk about the try, when we talk about the third thing, I think there's a question that comes that I really don't understand this concept.
What Irenaeus was trying to do is to Christianize and further break down the idea of soul. And he was basically trying to help the church understand a philosophical language in a very Christian term. Probably he was doing with the idea of helping the church. But what we are trying to see here is, has that really helped the idea of gender diversity and sexual diversity, is the kind of question that we need to ask here. Body and soul is yes, because these are commonly accepted idea in any religion, not just in Christianity. But where Irenaeus qualifies the idea of soul is by bringing the idea of spirit. This spirit is built into the soul because Jesus is in you. So that's where he Christianizes a philosophical idea. He was with a good intention, he was trying to break down philosophical ideas into a more Christian theological language. But we as Christian theologians and students at this point in time in Christian history should ask how these ideas of dichotomies and trichotomies helped us when we talk about gender diversities, gender and sexual diversities. From now on, Judy, anything more you want to say, or is that all?
So I think that's all. That's it.
Okay, thanks then. Anyone else before I?
Yeah, Rohan.
May I know who that
Hello?
Is? May I know who that is?
Rohan?
Prasanna. Okay. Oh, hi, Prasanna. Okay.
My internet is not really good, so I'm not able to put on video.
No problem.
Thank you very much for this wonderful speech. But then, one question, not a question, this is a kind of struggle with regard to this trichotomy concept. You know, this is a question which I'm struggling, but I don't have answer, and we're still struggling. You know, most of the time I do yoga, and I wanted to concentrate on something, okay? Maybe, for example, light. Concentrate on light, okay? That is what I wanted to do. But, and within few seconds, I call it mind, I don't know, still it is. And something else I'll be thinking, and then again bring it back and then concentrate. And after some time, again, it goes off and then bring it back. So what is that kind of thing? How do we understand that? Since if you can explore something or share it, if you have some thoughts about it. Mm-hmm. What do we call it? How do we call it? Is there something, a kind of soul and mind kind of thing? Or why these two things go on in the mind at the same time? Most of the time.
Prasanna, as you were asking that question, I was wondering whether I should really answer this question in the first place.
Let's discuss more.
We can put our thoughts together. Looks like our education has conditioned us to, from the beginning, has a religious education, philosophical education, cultural education, our own cultural teachings have from the beginning told us to look at everything in these binary terms. As a feminist, you will certainly understand. From the beginning, we are told who a male and what a male is, who a female and what a female is. If those things were not told, we wouldn't have struggled with gender discrimination. Likewise, I believe from the beginning we have been told in our Sunday school, in our churches, in our cultural teachings. You go to these revival meetings where they say, what happens today if you were to die? Where will your soul go?
Yeah.
Have you heard of any revival preacher telling what happens to your body if your body lives today and tomorrow? Has anyone asked this question?
Yeah, that's
I haven't heard any revivalist preacher or any preacher telling what will happen to a body if it lives today, tomorrow, or the next 10 years. Rather, they would ask, what will happen to your soul if you die today? So much of emphasis on the soul that we completely forget. And we are prepared to give away give up our body at any time because we think that body is nashvara. Is that the right word? I mean, body will perish, but the soul will live.
Yeah.
And therefore, when you are consciously awake, you only focus on the body that will die. So when you do yoga, you should go back to your most important element, which is mind or soul. See, I think we have been bombarded with these ideas. I think that's the reason why we struggle with this. Our education. Maybe others have different ways of explaining this. I don't know. I just give my thought.
What you said is true. But the struggle that I'm sharing is there are two things going on at the same time, whether it is mind or soul or spirit, how to name them is my struggle. I mean, but I'm not sticking onto this dichotomy system that to answer that dichotomic understanding only, I'm struggling this way. The two things going on in mind or spirit or soul, so which means there is not only one thing, there are two things, something like that.
What I was trying to say, I mean, I said it more positively, now I have to say it more critically. While Tertullian was trying to help the church, in the process of helping, he only complicated the issue, and now we are caught up in that complicated trichotomy. Prasanna, just as you said, you're trying to figure out whether it is the body or soul or mind. So Tertullian or Irenaeus have already put you on the wrong track in that sense. They did not say you are a complete being in yourself. They already broke you down into three. Now they are making you to check which one you are thinking of, which one you should shed, which one you should give up. Maybe the original intention was good, but now it is further complicated.
Sir, there is a question when you say Tertullian or Irenaeus put it into this problem. In the New Testament, there are, of course, the term for spirit, pneuma is there, then nous is there, and then for body, sarx is there.
Yes.
So I think that these early church fathers, they tried to put those Greek terms and then ideas behind that into a discussion, and they either they said it is dichotomy or trichotomy, and it's not their creation, as I think. It's from the scripture or from the Pauline or the Johannine theology. They have brought it forward.
You are exactly right, sir, Father Elias, and that's exactly what I said. And therefore, I was trying to say that we have studied Pauline theology on gender and sexuality. So I said early church fathers fall back heavily on biblical teachings. And when I say Paul, again, Paul falls back heavily on the philosophy of the time. Aristotelian philosophy is very famous for dichotomies and binaries. That's exactly what Paul brings into his philosophical ideas. And you are right in saying that you're further divided, whether it's the spirit, pneuma, what is that? So what I was trying to highlight here is maybe the preachers and the teachers, early teachers of faith, wanted to break them down to help us more with its understanding. But now our question should be, is it helping us more, or is it making us take positions in a way that we discriminate those who do not fall into certain categories? That's the critical question we're asking. If spirit is privileged, Because in dichotomies and trichotomies, spirit is privileged, soul is privileged. Body is never privileged. That's the question that I'm trying to bring forth here. Probably they were trying to help, but in the process of helping, they caused divisions in a way that they placed them in a hierarchical order. Spirit is here, soul is, spirit is here, soul is here, body is perish, is something perishable. You don't have to worry. So in the process of helping, they're complicated. So much so that we are using those broken down hierarchies to discriminate queer communities. That's the point I'm trying to come to.
Yes, of course, it is true, but it is, it's in, when it comes to New Testament, even in the Gospels teachings, there itself lies that hierarchy of body and the that hierarchy is there within the scripture, within the Bible. And so how it is to be dealt with, that's the question then comes. Because body is from the earth and it shall go back to earth. It's very sure, very, very clear in both Old and New Testament. And then when we theologize it, how it is to be, whether that hierarchy is to be maintained or how it is to be explained. That's the question.
Yes, probably one way of explaining your question is you went back to the doctrine of authority of the scriptures, because the more I explained, you went back to the scriptures, because as I get from you, scripture is authoritative, and therefore we fall back on the scripture as the final word. Is that, was that your idea, sir?
Sure, it has an authority. Otherwise, our existence itself is...
Going back to what I was trying to say earlier on, scripture is one of the formative factors of our
faith. Yes. No, see, when we come to the Orthodox or the Orthodox tradition says that Bible is one of the traditions, not the tradition or the authority. Bible is one of the traditions.
Yeah, and therefore, along with scripture, we have something called experience.
Yes.
And in this case, the experience of queer communities, where we have tradition that has been handed down to us. In other words, we call them doctrines, the doctrines and the teachings of the church. Then we have reasoning, what we are trying to apply here as method. We are trying to reason it out. So, and therefore, we are not privileging any one over the other. Jyoti, how much more time do I have?
Now time is up, I think 7 o'clock is the closing time.
Okay.
Yeah.